It's one thing when Chicago Mayor Rahm Emanuel appears in a front page article above the fold in the New York Times, which states that he was just named to GQ's list, the worst people of 2015. And when yesterday his office announced the mayor would indeed return from his vacation in Cuba 3 days after another deadly police shooting is tearing Chicago apart. And when, also today, protesters in Cleveland took the streets again following the grand jury's decision not to indict the Cleveland police officer who fatally shot and killed 12-year-old Tamir Rice. That's just the past 48 hours. The formidable power of the Black Lives Matter movement has been on full display this year. There's now full-fledged coverage of various police shootings across the country. The Department of Justice investigated the Ferguson Police Department, issuing a scathing report. Black Lives Matter protesters have disrupted candidacies and campaign events of liberal Democratic candidates to push them towards laying out a concrete civil rights agenda. Black Lives Matter is now front and center in Democratic debates, part of candid discussions behind the scenes. It is recognized by the President of the United States in the face of those who might choose to twist the very meaning of its name.
Black Lives Matter. And the reason those words matter is the African American community knows that on any given day, some innocent person like Sandra Bland can get into a car, and then 3 days later, she's going to end up dead in jail. Or their kids are going to get shot.
You can get lip service from as many white people as you can pack into Yankee Stadium, and a million more like it, who are going to say, oh, we get it, we get it. We're going to be nicer, okay? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's not enough, at least right. In my book. That's not how I see mm-hmm. politics.
The reason that the organizers used the phrase Black Lives Matters was not because they said they were suggesting nobody else's lives matter. Rather, what they were suggesting was there is a specific problem that is happening in the African-American community that's not happening in other communities.
And now, not only is a top cop in Chicago gone, there are calls for the resignation of one of the biggest Democratic figures in the country, Mayor Emanuel, who is right now hanging on to his political life by his fingernails. Joining me now, Jelani Cobb, staff writer for The New Yorker and director of the Africana Studies Institute, University of Connecticut. Dr. Phillip Atiba Goff, a co-founder and president of the Center for Policing Equity, and that is Redditt Hudson, former St. Louis police officer and co-founder of the National Coalition of Law Enforcement for Justice Reform and Accountability. Let me start with you, Jelani, you're at the table. I mean, what I felt I saw from a lot of people yesterday was exasperation, a kind of deja vu, a kind of here we go again. In some ways, the decision by the prosecutor and the grand jury had been so far telegraphed in advance, it wasn't a surprise. But I think it does leave people with, okay, what are we doing here? I mean, what is improving and what is not? What systematically are the places to apply pressure to sort of address the problem that is indisputably at a higher level of salience, but maybe is not being addressed yet. Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting that one of the things that you hear, like, you know, the left is always at war with itself in one way or another. And one of the things that you heard earlier in the year was this question about disruption and how valuable that was as a political tactic. When you saw Bernie Sanders disrupted multiple times in the attempt to disrupt Hillary Clinton's rallies and so on. And some people began to say, well, can Black Lives Matter do anything except disrupt? But when you look at what happened yesterday, what happened with Sandra Bland about 10 days ago, a little bit less, and, you know, the kind of trajectory that we've seen over the course of this year, it becomes clear that if you're simply relying on the mechanisms of kind of bureaucracy to function on your behalf, it's not going to happen. It's unlikely for that to happen. And so being outside of the system and being disruptive and causing protests and being in your face and kind of being in the airport when you want to fly out and those kinds of things actually become much more crucial than they would be otherwise.
Dr. Goff, what you work on this full time. You work with folks that are police departments and training police. I mean, do you feel like things have changed? There's this question right now, you know, you start to hear these things about, oh, body cameras or changing policing or independent prosecutors, all of which, many of which sound like good ideas, but also seem like they're sort of attacking around the edges of the huge problem, which is a country that has the largest criminal justice system in the developed democratic world.
Yeah, so I think you're hitting on exactly the right thing. I think that things are changing. It's not necessarily the body cameras, but definitely people's cell phones are changing the game. Since 2005, there have been about 54, roughly, officers who've been charged for their use of force. But this year, there were 17.
Right.
That's more than twice the number on average. And most of that, the uptick, is the result of cameras. But we're talking about 54 or 17. That's a small number compared to the 900 or so folks who were killed by law enforcement this year. And the reason why Black Lives Matter has been such a successful phrase, the reason it resonates in so many of these communities, is because we have a system that, while it is devoted to keeping people safe, it often feels as if it's certain people. And if that system isn't changed in terms of the mission and the resources that are made available to keep all folks safe, but particularly right. Black folks, then you're exactly right. We're going around the edges of a system that has been set up to not care about folks coming from certain places, and more importantly, to deal with the problem of social disorder and the problem of
right.
crime by taking people away as opposed to giving those people the resources to empower the community and make it unnecessary to engage in those behaviors in the first place.
Reddit, this gets to something I've heard. I've spent a lot of time talking to police for the last year and a half, and you know, they really do feel, a lot of them really do feel under siege. They feel it's similar in some ways to what I hear from teachers when they talk about the sort of political environment, that essentially everything's been laid at their feet. It's your problem. You're failing at your job. You're not doing the job. They feel like they're sort of encountering problems that are much bigger than policing can solve. And there's also this question of how you talk about risk in a way that both keeps officers safe but doesn't put into their heads the idea that every single person they encounter is going to shoot them dead in the next second.
Well, I've had the training that you just showed. All the officers in St. Louis get that same simulated kind of training, and nothing can really train you as far as how to respond to a deadly force situation. They can just expose you to what it's like to be in that situation.
Right.
It still goes to your own judgment, your own gut instincts, and your own assessment and ability to do that. But having the largest criminal justice system and the largest criminal justice prison industrial complex in the world is a problem for us now because it is operating entirely at a moral deficit.
Yeah.
The United States criminal justice system is operating at a moral deficit, and that deficit is built on the institutional racism that is at its foundation. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about to weave that into what you showed the viewers earlier and show you what I mean. In the entire 50-year history of blacks being significantly involved on the St. Louis Metropolitan Police Department, almost half a century, I can't name a single black officer that has ever shot at an unarmed white person. I can't name a single black officer that has ever shot at a white person, period. Mm-hmm. So restraint is possible,
right.
even in dangerous situations, even when you face risk that you've been trained in simulated environments to face. Restraint is possible, but it is black lives that are freely discarded in our process, and it is black lives that get triggers pulled on them, whether it's warranted or not, with zero expectation of accountability. And that is what's going to change, I think, in the powerful movement that you've seen young people build out around the nation, a new development that you can anticipate because I've been a part of conversations around it, is that blacks and Hispanics and people from marginalized communities who work in the criminal justice system, including police officers, prosecuting attorneys, defense attorneys, corrections officers who work in that system will join together to collectively make an effort to remake it, not reform it, because I believe that the system is functioning exactly as it was meant to be.
Well, this is the, I want to talk for a second about how this connects to safety, which is the fundamental thing at the heart of this, right? Mm-hmm. It's we want people to be safe. We don't want them to be subjects of violence, whether it's police violence, violence of fellow citizens. And a lot of talk earlier this year about the fact that the quote, so-called Fergus effect, we now have the data. I want to talk about that and what it means.
Hey, YouTube fans, I'm Luke Russert. Thanks for checking out our MSNBC channel. Subscribe by clicking right here and click any of the videos over here to watch the latest breaking news, mini documentaries, conversations from Shift, and other digital exclusives. Check it out.